Okay, my clock upstairs has just begun chiming 6 o'clock. So that means it's time to kick this live stream and kick start it. And I have to tell you guys that I'm still sick. I don't know how to kick this cold out. You know, I'm trying the best I can, drinking as many fluids as I can, resting. But, you know, life is life. And so often you just cannot lay around as much as I would like to and just, you know, have the rest that I need in order to maybe kick this cold. The weather has been just roller coaster, and I think that is a factor to the fact that I just can't get rid of the drippy nose, the sore throat, you know, everything that comes with it. Just the overall blah feeling. But anyway, I have to give that second thought because I have many other important things to deal with. And today, as we get started, I want to make sure that I am reaching out to the first few people that have joined us tonight. Mike Vernon, of course, he was here at 5:30. I saw his name crop up on my live chat. And of course, I wasn't even on the air yet. And he's always the first guy in line. Mike Vernon is here. Cliff Medina, Anthony Petit, Dag Leslie Hansen from Norway is here again with us tonight. We'll just wait a few more minutes. I just wanted to tell you guys that I have been working very diligently on some projects. Again, you may have seen my video with my new t-shirt. That was a prototype that I did. I use heat transfer type material. I will be using sublimation type system, which is superior and will produce superior results. I'll cover all of that. And basically, I wanted to begin, and I wish I had a few more people here, but I wanted to begin to just talk about some of the questions that have been asked on the Facebook group. And by the way, you saw my link to the ordering page for the profiles. Let me quickly show you what it looks like. Here we go. My name and email. You can click on it. It'll link you to me via email. This is the profile chart that you will download. The images are not tagged with any kind of color space. You just print them as is. You should be able to print on A4 if you are in Europe or any place that uses A4 rather than letter size. You should be able to do that without any problems. The X-Rite 1, what is it? I1 Pro 2 profiler will handle it. In fact, I just realized I can actually print on any size paper I wish. Again, so the beauty of it. So you would simply send me your printed charts. You would go down here and view the instructions if you haven't done so already. Here's an example of what it will look like when you print it. And then here is the ordering by buttons. Single profile 30, double profile 50, and the best deal, of course, is three profiles for $70. Now, if you just want to buy pre-made profiles for those of you who use the Pro 10 with the Signature Edition inks plus OEM Red, already I have made some profiles for that. And again, they are going to be for the Canon papers. The Canon paper line, and you just simply tell me what particular papers you're interested in. I'm gonna do pairs, only like $10 for the two profiles for the Pro 10 with that ink set for semi-gloss and Pro Luster paper, and that goes the same for the Pro 100. Again, it will also be $10 for two profiles. Now, I have not set the button for that. This here is for you to send me paper, and I will then run your profile charts that I already have, of course, through those printers and provide you with the finished profile for that particular paper you use. I didn't mean to confuse you. Yes. Click on this. You will buy a profile. Let it load up. See, one profile, $38. That includes shipping for me to send you back a reference print. That's why I need you to send me 4 sheets. 3 for the charts, 1 for me to print the reference print on the Pro 10 Signature Edition inks plus OEM Red. On the Pro 100 Signature Edition inks, the current ones. So you just send me the paper, I will produce a profile in-house for you. And then I will verify it at the end by simply printing my collage of the black and white reference image and the color reference image. I should get a perfect result. And so again, it'll be for your common papers. At this point, I will not take any canvas media because sometimes that's a little bit difficult to read with the profiler due to the texture, but any other paper will suffice. And so send me the paper. I will run them through those two, either one of those two printers, whatever you choose. And then I will go ahead and produce a profile, email it to you. And then I will also mail you back. That's what that extra $3 and something cents is. Actually $8, because it will be $30. And I will send it to you via priority mail here in the United States. At this point, I can only take US addresses only. So that is it for that. Let's go ahead and close that up. We don't need to hang around here much longer. Let's begin with some questions. Now, that was funny. Let's see who is on the chat at this point. Besides the names that I already read out. Oh, somebody's recommending a clove of garlic. I eat a lot of garlic, by the way. Today, I made some beans with a ton of garlic. So that's really helped me. It kind of lifted my spirits a little bit. I was feeling down all day long. And got somebody from Florida via Australia. Now that's unusual. I don't know what that means. Jim M9647, big smiley face. Bob Bruce, hello, Jose from Phoenix, Arizona. My in-laws are in Bullhead City, Arizona right now, in one of those snowbird type camps for people from the cold states up north. So they spent 3 months there and they're enjoying the heck out of that area there. They've been there now, I think, 4 years in a row already. And got Spike 597. Hello, Jose. And Courtney Jackson. Hi, Jose. Well, hi back at you, Courtney. Glad you're here with us tonight. I hope we can help you. And Tammy Flew for me. Yes, I'm going to look that up. Opaque paper for the Pro 10. What does that opaque paper mean, Courtney? Most paper is opaque. Please clarify it and I'll try to answer you. Is the Pro 10 worth $700? Thinking about buying, well, where are you? Where are you located, Courtney? If you are here in the US, there are deals. Well, there's one particular deal that you will not believe. You'll have to sit down to believe it. Murphy's Camera, I believe, is in Missouri or Kentucky. Just look it up online, Murphy's Camera. If you're here in the U.S., okay, that is paramount. You talk to Don, D-O-N, short for Donald. They will sell you a Pro 10 for about $350, plus you will get a $250 rebate. Now, all you have to do then is pay about another $50 shipping. You will get your Pro 10 for a net of about $100. That's including shipping. If you can pick it up yourself, $50. So let me know. And again, some of the people here have done that already, and they can vouch that this is actually a true deal. James Hines says, I bought my Pro 10 this week for $250. Some places are actually giving you the lower price because it is a $700 printer. But the best deal is for Murphy's Camera. Absolutely amazing. And I see that my buddy from Italy is here. Welcome, Paolo. And I saw your video on the printhead installation. I gotta push it. I gotta push it for you, my friend. Let me find it. Let me go ahead and look up that video. You guys have to watch this. Let me find it here. It should be under my subscribers. And it is right here. It is called Brother MFC5890CN and many others printhead installation. ADC SFX Works. He's one of the members here. Check him out, you guys. Check him out. He is amazing. I don't think I have the nerve to do that, but he certainly does, and he's great at it. So, great. So, okay, so let me go back a little bit. So, oh, Courtney, you are in Memphis, you say, and Spike lives in Wisconsin. So you are done. You are ready. Contact Murphy's camera. The number is right here, 8592 and 551013. Talk to Don. You will get a Pro 10, I'm telling you, for $100 total after the rebate comes in. And then once you master the Pro 10 using your original inks that you will be provided with, they are not the half empty or half full type set of cards, they are full cards. Learn how to use that bad girl, bad boy, whatever. And then if you wish, you can then move over to refilling and using Precision Colors brand new signature edition ink set plus OEM red. It's important to use that OEM red because, or the original red, because it has the gamut that no other third party red intended for that family of printers can provide. It just does not exist. So you have to supplement it with OEM red. Okay. So let's go back. We have somebody from Liverpool, cold and wet outside. Well, listen, John has been miserable here today. So I feel your pain. If you feel my pain, I feel your pain. Today has been a horrifically cold, damp, raining all day, horrible day. It's going to be the same way tomorrow as well, I heard. And at least it's not snow. And Chris Klug, hey, finally got back and logged in. Well, glad to have you here. And Paolo says, many thanks. And yeah, watch this guy's video. Some of them are in Italian. Some of them are in English. And I wish I could speak both languages like I do Spanish and English. I would love to learn Italian. I'm going to do that someday. Got it in my bucket list. Okay, let's go to the Facebook group. Now, somebody asked a very good question. I've got to keep checking here. I believe you recommend to keep the Pro 100 on, but mine turns itself off after 3 to 4 hours. My system is all working great. I don't have any other issues, but I can't keep it on. Well, I think I showed you that earlier, but one more time for you guys. And I don't know whether this person is with us tonight. I doubt it, but oh, here he is. Micah Wave. Great. I'm going to answer your question, Micah. Go to your driver. Settings, right click, preferences, and we'll minimize this so I have it handy. Maintenance, auto power, just disable that. See, disable and disable. That way it'll stay on all the time. Now, if by some chance you don't care about it going to sleep or turning itself off, then set it to some particular number of minutes. The maximum is 240 minutes and it will turn itself off. Okay, so I have it on disable because I don't want them to ever turn off. So that is it. That's where you set that. Okay, go there and set it up for it never to go off. It's not like it's going to go to sleep. It's not really sleeping. It's literally off. You'll have to use the power button to revive it. And it may run a cleaning cycle. Speaking of, this is on my list of topics, and I'm going to talk about that after we get done with some more questions here. the denial that some people have about what has already been reported, and not just by me, not by this biased person, by many others. All right, so Jeremy Meyer, Mayor. Hi, everyone. I am new to the group, and I have watched a ton of YouTube videos about cleaning the printheads on my Canon Pro 9500 Mark II. Remember last time I showed you a printhead? I think it was the video that I did about some sort of computer settings and some sort of driver settings for the Pro 1000, I think it was. Anyway, I showed you a printhead. That's a Pro 9500 printhead. Now, it appears that he got the printer new to make about 6 to 8 prints, then ran out of ink, and it sat for years. Okay, I bought a new set of inks from Precision Colors, and I have refilled all my empty carts. Now the nozzle check patterns have been sketchy, and I pulled and thoroughly cleaned the printhead, including the rubber seals around the cartridge seats, etc. I get an absolute perfect test sheet now on every color except yellow. I get no yellow. Well, then he goes on to, you know, what should he do? I would try removing that, get some good cleaner like Piezo Flush. Windex is good, but it's not the best. Piezo Flush specifically can dissolve really stubborn clog. Do not print with that printhead. If you do, that's it. It's gone. So, dribble some of that cleaning solution onto the yellow port from the top. Remember, the carts sit on top of the printhead. So, remove those carts, place the printhead on a tray with a wetted paper towel, let sit it right on the nozzle plate, right on the wetted paper towel, and start dripping Windex or, you know, the expensive Piezo Flush drip by drip by drip onto that yellow rear sponge. They call it a sponge. It's not really a sponge, but more like a screen. And see if any of that yellow starts to come out. If it does, continue doing it. Continue doing it. Continue doing it. And then drip some warm distilled water and see if you can wash it out. All you can do at that point is put it back in the printer, install all your cartridges, run a cleaning cycle. It'll do a clean purge anyway, an ink purge. And then you can do another nozzle check, but do not print images, just nozzle checks. Hopefully you will open up that channel. If not, then you just need a new printhead and don't let it sit for 2 years again. That's the only recommendation. That's what happens. That's what happens. All right, we have a couple more here and I'll jump over to YouTube and answer some of those questions from the viewers. Now, not all the viewers are members of the Facebook group. We're up to 600 and some odd members now, so that's really good. Any ideas on these or the following observations? I have a Pro 100 Canon. I use this will bring us through the cleaning cycle, automatic cleaning cycle triggered by time debacle. Okay. And I discussed that on the video that I showed you my new t-shirt. Yeah. I received a comment by someone via private message that someone, very well-known person, had stated that that was just a myth. Yeah. Okay. All right. Let's go ahead. So he has two computers, one Canon Pro 100. And basically he's getting different results using it between the two computers as far as idle times. He says that computer one I use for web surfing, emails, and some photo printing, and then the other computer he uses for editing images and printing strictly. So I always print something every 48 to 50 hours on computer one. So here is my observation. If I do a print one day ago on computer one or two, can be within 60 hours also. So, and then he says, and then go to the other printer and do a print one day later, the printer still does a purge. So he's saying that just from a different computer, even though he has not exceeded the 60 hours, he gets a purge. Now, if he just does it on one computer, no problem. If you print under 60 hours, he doesn't get it per cycle. There's also been reported that after like 7 days, even if you print every day, it will run a cleaning cycle, some sort of maintenance cycle. And again, this has all been engineered into Canon printers, especially your photographic type printers. And some of the people have truly complained about their little MX type Canon models, you know, desktop little A4 or letter size printers for office work. They have a built-in scanner, you know the type, a all-in-one. They literally run themselves dry if you don't use them often. So that takes care of that myth, kind of. Let's go ahead and jump over here and see what else we got here. So I got someone here from Slovenia, Europe. Wow, that's very good. Welcome. And Courtney says, can you print on all types of paper on the Pro 10? You can print on all RC type papers, glossy, luster, satin, semi-gloss, you name it, matte, canvas, art papers. Yeah, it's a very versatile machine, and one that can print on quite a few different medias. So yeah, it's a very good machine. If I had to choose, and I only had enough space, I would keep the Pro 10, and the rest would have to go. Now, my Pro 1000, I would cry and kick and scream, and my Pro 1 as well. But the Pro 10 is just really that good, and you just cannot beat those deals. It does produce really, really great output. Adam McKenzie from Jamaica, are you saying that both must be on disable? I don't know about the upper icon. Let me take another look at it. I have them both on disable just because. No particular reason. The auto power on. Okay, that means that, I think that means that if you put it on enable and you try to then print something, maybe it goes to sleep if I choose enable after a period of time. I'm not really sure. I can't answer that. I just have them both on disable, and the printer just stays on all the time and everything. I just send a print job, boom, it starts printing. So I cannot say for sure. I need to check that. We'll see. Maybe that does mean something. Maybe I should read the instruction manual, right? Yeah. Oscar says, hello, Jose, I have a Canon Pro 1000 and I love it. But one thing I'm curious about is I did not find in your videos is what the paper selection on the printer display makes. Okay. If I get your question, I think you're talking about the paper selection choices. What do they really do? I did a video just on that subject. I would tell you, look it up, but you're here with us tonight, so I will answer that for you. We'll go directly through the Pro 1000. Here we go. So what we have is a bunch of different paper types, as you can see. Photo printing, of course, that's what we pick. We have Pro Platinum, plain paper, all of these other papers, fine arts, we have all of these papers, and Hagaki, Japanese type papers here. This does not set a profile, okay? This sets physical parameters that are specific to those papers, meaning the surface type, which will then dictate the ink density applied to reach a certain set of values. In other words, a photo would print lighter on certain papers, so it needs more ink density, prior. That will bring it to match the results on some other paper, which might require a slightly different ink density. And so that's, my throat is getting so dry. So that's what that sets up. It sets up the paper thickness so that the platen is set at the correct height or gap, and that sort of thing. If you want to print through the driver, then you just tell it to control color and don't bother with anything else. You would use your ICM setting, or your match driver matching setting right here. You will simply say driver setting or ICM. ICM will actually assign the standard profile for that paper. And again, it's kind of like a semi color management, but through the driver. But if you really want to use color manage workflow through your printing application, you would print, you would pick none. So matching none and okay. But as far as what you asked about, the paper types that are located on the drop-down menus of drivers, they just simply assign physical parameters that are determined by the thickness of the paper, the paper surface type, and the ink density requirements. And that is it. Nothing to do with color management, nothing to do with color reproduction. Okie dokie. So I hope that answered that question. And somebody has, Chris Cluck says that his new Pro 100 arrived today. That was when, on the 8th, and worked with Don on the deal. I'm very happy and I owe it all to the help and advice I've gotten here. Thank you, he says. Fabulous. What a seal of approval that is. Doug Bradshaw. I bought a new ink refill kit from Precision Colors a few months ago. Just went to use the resetter and no light. Okay, this guy had a problem with one of the little pins on the resetter itself, literally fell off. All you gotta do is contact Mike from Precision Colors. I am absolutely positive he will send you a replacement. And Sue Matero, she posted this direct to Garmin type printer. Look at that. Isn't that amazing? An Epson SureColor F6200 printer, large format. It prints on rolls of material, just like canvas, but this is not really coated, okay? This is, it's not specially treated material. The inks are special. And so that's amazing. You can open up a business. Anyway, okay, that's enough. Oh, here I am with my new shirt here. Again, I'm going to get into that in a little bit, but I want to go back to, let's see what I have here, the comments on YouTube. Now, when I received that notice about the so-called denial, or saying that the Canon printers auto cleaning cycles triggered by, you know, a certain number of hours is nothing but a myth. And so I said, well, then I must be hallucinating, right? Because I have probably all of the Canon printers that are available in four different families right now, and they all do this, okay? So again, it's not 1960s. I'm not tripping, guys. I'm seeing this happen, so it's not a myth. And please don't be in denial. Use your printers as indicated by the results of what me and many others have witnessed, that it will begin to run those cleaning cycles if you do not have any job sent to the printer within 60 hours. Why do you think that Precision, I mean, not a QImage device and design that so-called scheduling, it's not a purge sheet, it's a so-called unclog sheet. Why do you think they implemented that? They did, not just for fun, but to make sure that you beat that system by printing under 60 hours. And also while you're away on vacation, you can set it to print. If you have an Epson printer that's not, it's not affected by that as much, you can have it print, say, a job every 2 or 3 days while you're away, one of these prints. And yeah, it's a true thing. If you deny it, you can deny it. That's fine. Go ahead and deny it and don't believe it and continue wasting ink. That's what's going to happen. Now, let's see. To stay here on topic. Yeah. I got several more things to discuss that you guys may want to know about. But I put out that information and I've gotten some good comments from people laughing out loud, no time cycle, then ask them why my matte black ink goes empty when the printer is only printing on glossy paper. Yeah, folks, on a Canon, you don't share channels. So the matte black, photo black are on separate, unshared channels. So when these cleaning cycles are performed, all of the inks are being purged. And so whether you've ever printed a drop, use a drop of matte black, as in this case, to actually lay down on prints, you will waste that complete, eventually, that complete matte black channel on waste ink cleaning cycles. It will be wasted because it has to use all 10 channels to run that cleaning cycle. So even if you just print on glossy, it's still going to suck some ink out of the matte black. So indeed. Okay, so Randy Davidson, you will, from this day forward, forever be known as the man. Wow, that's a nice title. You just saved me hundreds. Bless you, brother. Wow. Well, if that's the case, you guys, and I've done that for some of you guys here, consider super chatting tonight again. That really helped that day's revenue. It was only about $15 total because they do take a bit of the super chat amount. And so please consider doing that. If you have a really difficult question to ask and you want me to devote some time tonight to that question, please consider a few dollars super chat, and that will help us tremendously. Alrighty, let's go on to other questions here. These are all interesting. Then we'll get into the subjects of tonight's broadcast. Again, I'm also going to talk to you about something that's been happening lately that's a little bit disconcerting, but I'm going to just do this and brush it off, because I know 99% of you guys don't feel that way. Okay. Some of these are kind of personal. Someone here wants to get into sublimation printing, and is looking forward to some tutorials that I presumably will be doing in the future for those of you who are interested. So we can talk about that as well. Okay, that's good enough. That's fine. Let's go ahead and close this a minute. I want to quickly show you. Remember I told you that YouTube is changing their qualifying conditions, or whatever you want to call them, to become a YouTube partner in order to be able to earn revenue. Well, here's my analytics. You can see them right here. I'm open to everyone. You need 4,000 view hours. In other words, 4,000 watch time, they call it, in the last 12 months, the last 365 days. So tomorrow it'll move up day by day. The last 365 days, you have to have 4,000 hours, and you have to have 1,000 subscribers. Well, we're up to 12,000 something subscribers now. And this is just in the last, since February 1 to the 9th, I have 4,868 hours of watch time. So that is thanks to you guys. You guys are the ones that are putting me way over the requirement to maintain my monetization and my partnership with YouTube. But for those of you who, if any of you are starting up a channel, you have to come up with some way to have 4,000 view hours within the last year. So again, you get in it for not for the money, but for the fun of sharing and educating people, or just a place to be able to freely upload your video and have it available for anybody to view. And it's for free. You're basically using their platform for free. So in a way, that is the reason I originally started. I just wanted a place to load my stuff, and I could keep it for free there, and nobody would ever charge me any money for a server use, right? Well, they started their partner program, and now we are here. So these are the requirements now: 4,000 hours in the last 365 days. I have beaten that by 868 hours in just the last 9 days. So we are doing really well. This is my revenue for this month so far. You can see from the 1st to the 9th, we've earned $266.70. Now, let me tell you what's been going on. I did this video, and this video here is my biggest earner so far. About 200 and something thousand views. I opened the video, and I think I haven't gone back to watch it, but I opened the video basically to discuss head clogs, and also I think I got another one about the little known Canon secrets. And I've been getting a lot of hate comments. I mean, calling me an idiot. I can actually put a glass eye to sleep. That's how boring I am. Well, you guys know me. You guys know me. You guys know how I present things. I am a detailed person. I don't want to have you have to come back to me and ask half a dozen questions after the video that I did not cover just because I wasn't complete. So I guess what I want to say is that if you just want a 3 minute, 1, 2, 3, 4 pipe, 5 points without any explanation about the details, then, you know, you're in the wrong place. This is not what I do. I give longish, highly detailed videos. And boy, my voice is going. And I also have a habit of talking about my family. And I did ask you guys a long time ago whether you guys minded that or not. And you guys said you loved it. So I have tried not to do that in the last series of videos that I've been uploading. Just kind of stay with the subject, so to speak. Unless it's something really important that occurred, I'll kind of slip that in midway through the video. But I try not to, you know, talk about my time with Nathan or the kids or this and that or my trips, you know. Well, anyway, so that is it. I obviously, these folks have a very short attention span. And really, if they are looking for that type of video, they're not going to find it here. This is going to be a whole different experience. But anyway, it kind of hurts your feelings a little bit. So you know what I do? Instead of leaving them on there so you guys can see them and then pounce on them, I delete them. I just delete them. And if they get really nasty, I block them. So that is it. I see that I got a huge super chat here from Lazy Dog. That is my good friend from Australia. Thank you so much, my friend. Always appreciate your help and support and your comments. Now, let's change the subject. Let's get into something more pleasant here, and we will talk about sublimation. I believe that is my next. Oh, no. No, 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 no. Not yet. PC K3 HD inks. I call it 2.0. You know, they sent them to me about a week, almost 2 weeks ago, and I had not had a chance to experiment with them. I just finished the whole testing for those inks against OEM, okay? OEM K3 Vivid Magenta on the 3880. I'm gonna have a video this week. Today is Saturday, so by Monday, I will produce the video and upload it. And you will see prints made on Staples Glossy. Why did I use that? It's one of the freakingest, glossiest papers you will ever come across. And a nice heavy base, really a beautiful paper. And it's sold by Staples under their name. It's made in Germany by some maker. I really do not know who. But I purposely used that paper in order for me to test the glossiness of these new ink sets coming out of the Precision Colors inventory. So the PCK3 HD, I call it the 2.0 because it's an improved version of the one currently being sold. He will have that available pretty soon. I think it's getting it bottled up right now. So I did testing on that paper using the OEM profile for premium glossy for the 3880, but using Staples glossy as the actual paper. So I wanted to see how well the OEM profile would work on that particular paper with OEM inks. I got that done, and then I proceeded to swap inks over to the PC inks, and I did the same thing, and then I made profiles with this baby right here, and I have the results. Then I proceeded to make some 13 by 19s prints on Epson semi-gloss. Okay, I had a pack of that, and so I decided to use that, made some beautiful prints. I was looking for linearity on my black and whites. I was looking for great color reproduction. I was looking for strong color reproduction on some prints, that images that were a little bit demanding, and some inks would just fall on their faces trying to produce these colors. And I'll have the results for you guys to see this Monday. So that should be fun. Okay, so now, let's talk about Canon. Okay, let's talk about sublimation inks. I got them here. These inks, and I have cards here for I wrote it here, CX700 from Epson, that I happen to have in box. So I'm going to dedicate that little printer to print on these sheets. Now, these are not sublimation size type sheets, but they are heat transfer. And so the idea is to load the inks on these cards, and you dedicate that printer to that, because once you start with sublimation inks, you just really cannot go back to regular type photo inks. You have to stick with that. So that'll be it. Once I get started, I will be ordering this particular kit right here. And you can see it here. It's a 16-1 heat press, specifically designed for sublimation production work. It has the mug heat press, different size applications here for taper mugs, for parallel mugs, for baseball hats, and for even printing on ceramic plates. Of course, I'll only be using for mugs and for shirts. So that is what I'm getting. That will be coming pretty soon. So somebody also asked me about Red River. I did talk to Drew, the president, and sad to say, I have not heard anything back. He seemed to be very enthusiastic about me collaborating with them. And so I just asked them to please, you know, provide us with some papers, some of their higher end papers. I'm specifically interested in the big sheets. These papers come in sort of odd sizes, like 13 by 38, 8.5 by 25, and 17 by 25. And also, I wanted to delve into some of the better high fine art papers. He's got fine art canvas. He's got, let's see, I gotta find it here. Yeah, here we go. So the Paladuro etching, that's really, really good paper. Paladuro semi-gloss rag, I've used that. San Gabriel Barita semi-gloss, that's a 2.0. Aurora Art, I've shown that in some of my prints. Aurora Art Natural, which is a warmer paper vase, and Blanco matte canvas. And so that's what I'm hoping that they would provide us. But again, you know, he's a busy guy, and I'm going to drop him a email maybe tomorrow, and so he'll see it Monday morning and just kind of ask what's up, you know, because I'm anxious to get into that for you guys. Let's see, somewhere before the super chat by my friend. Okay, Adam McKenzie says, hey Jose, I saw in one of your videos in which you state using Epson Canon Pro 100 ICC profile on the Canson Aquarella watercolor paper. Can you elaborate? All I did, okay, all I did for the Pro 100 was to choose matte, the matte paper choice. There's a video where I actually just show you the results. I don't actually go through. I think I do. Maybe I do. And I think there's a couple of videos that show you how to print on the Pro 100 using that Canson paper. And the results were good. It could stand to be profiled because I did get a color shift compared to the results done on a K3 printer using their particular, like for example, I think I matched it to the 3800 using Fine Art Watercolor something by Epson. And that produces a really good result with that particular paper. But yeah, it works. It works great. The blacks are not going to be as deep as you would expect them with a pigment printer, especially one dedicated with that has a dedicated matte black ink. Of course, you're not going to get that kind of depth to your blacks. Okay. I keep losing track of the chat here because there seems to be quite a few people. Let me check something here. See how many people we have. We have 44 people on board. That is amazing. Last week, I think we peaked out at 34. So that's awesome. Thank you guys for joining us tonight. Okay. All right. I'm too far back here. Okay, so Courtney wants to know, I'm sorry, I keep mispronouncing your name, Courtney. Is Murphy's a brand new printer? Yes, it's brand new. Brand new printer. Inbox. And Oscar Helgeson, not in the driver manager, but on the display on the printer. Oh, okay. So he's talking about, I think, referring to the disabling. The Pro 10 does not have a display. The Pro 1000 does, Pro 1 does not. So you have to do, if you're going to disable the timed powering off, you have to do it in the driver for the Pro 100, Pro 10, Pro 1. Pro 1000, you can do that on the display LED on the driver directly. James Hine answers Courtney. Saying $50 net cost after rebate delivery is extra. Yeah. And she thanks him. Adam McKenzie. Hi, Jose. I saw in one of your videos that you say, okay, I answered that. And what kind of software does the Pro 10 come with? Just the driver. It comes with the driver. It should have like the Canon Print Studio Pro plugin as well. That allows you to print sort of away from Photoshop. You're in Photoshop or Lightroom to be able to use it, but what it does, it kind of takes over the driver really as well, and it is a very easy way to color manage your output without having to worry about all of the settings that you have to, you know, follow. So the PSP, as we call it, plugin is quite good at that, and it allows you to do some pretty good layout strategy and setup. And it's very accurate. It's really good. I have some videos that cover that. If you want to check them out, just search for PSP or Print Studio Pro on my channel, and you should be able to find them. ADC SFX works. Large format printers mostly use in ink called eco solvent based. Yeah, the large format printers used for vinyl and signage for outdoor type work. Yeah, they use the solvent-based inks, which are not water-based like the ones that we normally use for printing photographs. Courtney says, Jose, have you ever printed t-shirts before? No, I have not. And so that is what I want to start getting into. And not so much for me to start a business selling t-shirts. No, I can't compete with the companies that already do that. We have a couple of them nearby, as I discovered just recently. And but I like to do things myself, and that is why I could very easily ask them to produce me X number of t-shirts in, you know, whatever sizes I need. But I want to do it myself for a while, and so that's why I'm getting into that nice heat press outfit and sublimation printer right here, or inks and carts. Yeah, I want to do that myself, so I need to, okay, what advice can I give you? I cannot give you any advice yet, because I haven't started. So, been watching a lot of videos on YouTube on how to do that. And so that's where I am at right now. So learning, learning, learning. And Courtney says, huge fan, Jose, you rock. Thank you so much. I didn't know I was getting a fan base, but, you know, people just don't believe me. There are some that actually like me. Nico Hanila, appreciate your work on printer videos. They are interesting and very helpful and understandable. Thank you so much for doing this. Yes, I hope I don't put too many people to sleep. I tend to ramble on too long, but I'm hoping that when I do that, I am providing you with as much detail and information as possible. So then at the end of the day, when you finish watching that video, you understand what was discussed and you don't have any questions. In other words, things have not been left unanswered. And again, some people only have attention span of a goldfish. You've heard the story. The goldfish goes around the bowl, and by the time it goes around, it forgot where it was. It seems that some people are like that. They want things like that in 2 minutes, 3 minutes. They want to discuss the installation of a Pro 100 in just 5 minutes. No, it takes an hour, okay? That's how long it's going to take. And that's how long my video is, and it's probably the best video out there on the Pro 100. Not because I say so, people have said so. And so you could always skip through parts, you know. I mean, I just want to be as complete as possible. I don't want people to make mistakes. In the Army and then in the lab that I worked for 28 years after the 22 years in the Army, we did not have any excuses for mistakes. Mistakes, you just, no excuse for mistakes. So we were very, very precise, and everything had to be said just correctly, especially when I was working in the bio threat lab. And so, you know, that was your life, you know, on the table there. So yeah, there's no room for mistakes. So I try to be as thorough as possible. And unfortunately, some people just don't have the attention span for that type of presentation. All right, so you tell the truth, plus you actually got the printers. Yeah, and that's what someone asked me about, you know, like, why do you have, at one time I had 23 printers. Like, why do you have so many printers? Well, because when I started with the channel, I had about 3 printers, and people asking me questions, and I could, you know, I could give them answers, generic answers about what this other printer does when you do this to it, but that would not be specific about, you know, the printer they're asking. It's about if I have a Toyota Corolla and somebody asks me a question about some other Toyota, well, I better have the model that they are asking questions about. So that's how it evolved, and I was buying used printers and refurbishing them myself. And Paolo knows what I'm talking about. And so he's done that many, many times. And so that's the reason. And so you have to have analogs so that you can, you know, make direct comparisons that will make sense according to the questions they're asking. So it wasn't because I just wanted to collect printers, which of course it was. Yeah, but officially I tell people that that was not the reason, but we know better, right? Okie doke. So, Andrew Dennis, don't take any such nonsense personally. Sadly, it is YouTube. Yeah, I know, and I try not to. What I do is I just, you know, I always take it and I ask myself, well, is there any reason they're saying that? And then what can I do to, you know, improve matters? But, you know, you do take it personal. I know. You're not supposed to, but you do. All right. You inspire, educate, and are genuine. Yes, that's what I try to be, genuine. I'm not going to I'm not going to be someone I am not in front of you guys. Just keep yourself, keep being yourself, and ignore the few percent of idiots. Yes, I love that. Adam McKenzie, continue talking about your grandson, Jose. That is nice. Yeah, I'm going to do that. I'm going to do that. I'm going to continue. And again, sometimes it just doesn't make sense because I want to get to the point so that I don't get the criticism, you know. But I may just do a couple of videos that will just be almost like a vlog, just what happened to me today or this week. I might do that once a week. How about that? Would you guys mind? Let me know. It's like a way for you to, if you had a rough week, you can purge yourself of that stress and have people that actually want to listen to what you did. That's what vloggers do now, and they tend to have millions of fans. I don't know if anybody wants to really listen to what happened to me this week, but if you do, I will do a once a week vlog where I will tell you, you know, what I've done. I'll throw in a little printing stuff as well in there. I can do that as well. As long as you guys want to hear my personal life, what I've done, and because my personal life affects what I do in that print dungeon in there. And if it gets in the way, then, you know, we suffer. No more videos about printing, right? I have to balance the two. So I'll be willing to do that if it's okay with you guys. AD, okay, Paolo says, talking about the details of everything is key. If I do a video where I a workforce 4640 printhead without showing that I unpressurized the ink system, every viewer would have their room sprayed with ink. Exactly. You nailed it. You nailed it. If you leave out that important, and I have watched so many videos where I go like, wait a minute. Okay, that was only 5 minutes. Fine. It was to the point. Boom, 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 boom. 1, 2, 3, 4, A, B, C, D, E, F, G. But what about, oh man, when I go to try to do what they did, I find out that they left out all of the important parts. Okay. Yeah, I got you. I get you perfectly. And I'm glad you get me perfectly. That is exactly ink. I don't, exactly it. I don't want anybody to come back and say, well, what you said didn't work because you left out. You see what I mean? I can't do that. I can't afford to do that. Courtney says, I'm gone. Send you a super chat when I get the printer from Murphy's. You just saved me $400. I got you. Oh, that's great. All right. Thank you so much. And yeah, talk to them and tell them that I have been recommending them, because at this point, I've probably sold about 50 of their printers for you by spreading the word. So tell them to contact me. Tell them to contact me if they want to. That'll be good. I can actually do, maybe they can do a little sponsorship. How about that? Adam McKenzie says, which ICC profile should I get with the Canson watercolor? It is 140 pounds and 300 grams. Well, if you're using an Epson printer, let me open up the control panel and get into the driver. Oh, I have it open already, right here. Let's just pick, for example, the P800. Epson printer with K3 inks, in other words, pigment. So, fine art. This one here works really great. Watercolor paper, radiant white. Okay. That works really great for the P600, R3000, P800, 3880, 2880, any of those Epson printers that use matte black and K3 inks. In other words, K3 meaning black plus two grays. Now, Pro 10. We'll just open up the Pro 10, and I did the wrong thing here. Let's get the right one. Alrighty, so let's do the SPS driver. So here you would take and choose either fine art paper and photo paper premium matte. Okay, that's it. Choose that. Now, that will impart a leading and trailing edge border. So if you do a 13 by 19 and you choose a 1-inch border all around, it'll be fine. You know, it'll look normal. It'll look like a fine art print. Now, the paper comes in kind of odd sizes. I think it's 12 by 18, 18 by 24, 9 by 15, really odd sizes. They're not what we consider photo sizes, but you can work around that. Pro 1000 is a little bit better. Pro 1000 will allow you to print using the regular matte black photo paper type. Perfect. That's what I use, and I just let the printer handle it. Okay, I don't even use any kind of a color manage workflow through my application. I just choose that and tell the printer to not turn the driver to tell the driver to control color, and that is what I do. And the print that I made that I gave away, that's the way we printed it. So great, works really nice. Okay, and Andrew Dennis sent $20 super chat. Wow. Andrew, do you have any specific question you want to ask? I would be glad to jump over everyone else and handle your question first. I see you have a question down here immediately. And it says, by the way, have you used Red River for decades? And they have that. He has used Red River for decades, and they have some very good papers, good profile support and samplers. Yes, I started using Red River probably around the turn of the century. So like 2001-ish. Remember the Y2K debacle where everybody thought that computers were just going to die? The whole digital system was going to die. Well, I had a computer and a printer. That was my first experience with printing. And yeah, I've been using Red River since then. I've used their sample packs, tremendous sample packs. You can't beat those. I actually found out one time they were offering both their fine arts sample pack. Let me see if there's any way to find those here quickly. Anyway, so they were basically giving away their sample packs for something like $7 for each sample pack. So what I did was I bought 10 sample packs of each and ended up with, you know, a good supply of papers in all of these types that were included in that sample pack. So made out like a bandit. And so I was able to then experiment and use some of these more odd, if you want to call them, papers, or more high-end papers instead of the regular common RC coated ones. And that's how I discovered the joy of printing, really, because I was able to print on all of these different types of surfaces and get some amazing results. And again, they're very good about support. And now that I can personally talk to Drew, the president, I hope that we can actually set up something that will really be beneficial for not only them, but also our viewers here. And technically speaking, I mean, I got 12,000 possible customers. What more would you ask for? You know, so that should open up some doors for them as well as us. And also, he's going to promote some of my videos. If I do a video testing a specific paper, then he would then promote it through the so-called forum that they have. They have a forum and a blog and so on that they publish, so that they can then promote me as a kind of a reciprocal payment. In other words, I don't want money. I just want papers and a little publicity for the channel. And he said that he gets over 70,000 members on that forum. So I would love to add 70,000 more subscribers to my channel. That would be amazing. There's something that YouTube gives you. It's called the silver play button. It's a frame, beautiful silver play, you know, the little play button icon. And they give you that when you reach 100K subscribers. We're a long way off, but that would certainly help. And yeah, that would be great. Okay, let's see. Nico wants to know, can you use Canon Pro 100 or Pro 10 for sublimation printing? You know what? Probably not. Okay, the reason is that the inks are pigment. You see how opaque this pigment is? How bright yellow it is? If this was dye, it would be kind of a transparent, kind of deep brownish color for the yellow. Yeah, these are pigment inks. They're sublimation pigments. And I'm sure you know what sublimation means, but for those of you who may not know, it means the act of changing a solid directly into a gas. So, for instance, you sometimes have a lot of ice outside after a hard winter, and you see the ice disappearing, but it's not really melting. Under specific conditions, ice will sublimate into vapor without having to go through the liquid phase. So what happens is special paper, you print on that paper with these inks, and then you put it in contact with the polyester fabric. And again, cotton will not work. It has to be polyester. And you apply heat at a certain temperature, 300 and something degrees Fahrenheit, and for a specific period of time. And the solid inks that are on the paper, that image that you created, will literally become gaseous and molecularly bond or penetrate the fibers of that polyester fabric. And so the fibers themselves become red, orange, green, blue. It's not a coating. It's not a coating. It's not like this material that literally just melts onto the fabric and then you peel it off. And it gives you that plasticky vinyl feel. No, sublimation, the fabric will not change in characteristics. You can throw it in the washer, you know, it will not peel off, it will not rub off, it'll just be almost permanent at that point. So that is the difference. So it's sublimation means from solid to gas, and it's all triggered by heat of a specific temperature. And that's where these little let me see, these little types of heat presses come into play. And this is quite a good one. It's a pretty good deal, $334 for a 6-in-1. I think this is 6-in-1 or maybe 7-in-1, I don't know. Anyway, it has different size. You see the different size tapered mug things. Now, you have to buy, in order to be able to do that, you have to buy the correct material. So they actually sell a case of 80 mugs for a given amount of money. And so it's going to be something where I will have to sell a mug for about $15, including shipping, to be able to kind of make a profit, because they're not cheap. Neither are the shirts. The shirts are not cheap at all. So it would be like a $25 shirt in order for me to be able to turn a profit. That would make sense for me to actually do the work myself and ship it. So anyone that wants to start doing that, you have to consider the fact that you can't just use $3 bulk cotton t-shirts or v-necks, or it has to be polyester, or at least a very high blend polyester type fabric. The plates and mugs are coated as well. Somehow the ceramic glazing that they use is of a certain characteristics that is able to molecularly bond with the sublimate that is given off that paper. If any of you are curious, just look it up on YouTube. There are tons of videos. And companies like Condi, Conde, Systems, they specialize in sublimation. There are even special sublimation printers that you can buy, several thousand dollars. But you can convert a regular printer if it's out of the box. It has to be a printer that can take pigment inks and refillable carts, but not a Canon printer. Okay, it has to be Epson, I think. The print heads go through a beating with this type of ink. They really do. And there is also white ink available so that you can print on dark materials without having to worry about where, how am I going to produce a white. So let's see what else we got here. Adam McKenzie says, yes, you did. Wow, got an arrow here. I can't see it. Yes, you did. I lost it. Yeah, it jumped. Hang on. Hang on, guys. Oh, boy. Yeah, he wanted to know what ICC profile did I use. Again, that one, the watercolor profile that I show you, the name of the paper, then you look up that profile. If you have that printer installed, it should have that profile installed as well. So, hey Jose, did you still plan on buying the Canon Pro 2000? Yes, that is why I'm doing that. That is why I'm doing all of this, to generate money. See, I got to spend a little bit of money here, $234 plus the sublimation material, prints, you know, the paper, and the mugs and the shirts, so that I can then generate what I need. I need $2,400. To get the Pro One Pro 2000. Yep. So I am not moving off to sublimation stuff right now. I'm still committed to photo printing. Believe me, guys. I'm just doing this as a sort of a secondary road to develop some merchandise that I can sell in order to then generate funds for the Pro 2000. And at that point, I think that's where I'm going to culminate my room, until Epson and Canon comes up with something that's astronomically better. That is it. I'm just going to concentrate now on photography and printing. Somebody says that I am having a problem with my audio. Anyone else having problems listening to me? He says that I keep cutting out. I haven't had any other person tell me that, so I hopefully it's just something happening at your end, a glitch or something with the streaming. But again, no one has told me otherwise, so maybe I should start wearing a little headset so that I can actually hear myself as I'm being captured by the microphone. Nico Hanila. That's what I meant, like you stated, giving specific information by showing every step while explaining what every single checkbox does in menus is very helpful. People should have more patience. Yeah. Again, the idea is, say I invite you over to a live seminar at some library, and I get a group of 20 people. And I give a presentation with a projector on a laptop and so on. And I got a couple of printers there, and I want to, you know, demonstrate certain aspects of printing. I don't want you to go home and then have questions. Again, of course, my session would include a question and answer period. But I don't want you to go home and then think, ah, I still have unanswered questions. How do you do this? No, I hope that during that period of time I covered everything to the point where, again, yeah, it's probably overdone, but it's better than going home without having all of the answers, because I want to be able to predict every question you will ask. And that's what I try to do every time I present something. I try to think, okay, if I was on the other side, what would I ask? And then I try to cover all of that. I appreciate what you just said, and yeah, that's what I'm trying to do. So 200 Mike K says, oh, you seem to be okay now. Okay, great. And he's in Brooklyn. The Lightworks, Señor Rodriguez, just joining the chat. How's your grandson feeling? He is feeling a lot better. This comes and goes. This comes and goes. And I'm wondering, because he just had a high fever and no real symptoms like flu symptoms or anything like that. He just had a high fever and it just knocks him out. I have a bad cold right now, is what I have. And this cold has been lingering for about 2 weeks now. So, again, because I cannot afford to just stay home and just, kick back on my recliner and relax, I got things I gotta get done. I got commitments with other organizations that I, associate with and support and volunteer for. I need to be out. And so I try my best. I take my medications that I need for the cold, try to make me feel better, but then eventually it just catches up with you. And but yeah, Nathan is doing good. We just went to high school yesterday. He was having this is, Valentine's Day is coming, so the school had a sweetheart lunch, and he was asked by the family, "Who do you want to be your sweetheart for your lunch?" And he picked me. So I went out to Panera and I bought him lunch and I took it to the school and I sat with the rest of his classmates and we had a great time. And then I was able to take him home with me. So we had an early out. So he was very glad and very happy to be for the rest of the day by himself with Grandpa. And he's a very jealous boy as far as anybody sharing me. So, including sharing me with my wife. So there you go. Yeah, I think I created a little monster, but I love that little monster. Adam McKenzie, Jose, I'm using the Canon Pro 100. Yeah, so you were referring to, I think, printing on the Canson paper. Is that what that was? So matte paper choice, that's all I used. And so it worked, but it created a bit of a color shift compared to the one that I sort of color managed. It was still a pleasant look. It was just a generic landscape. And I think it was more of in Virginia, our Great Falls, Potomac River, Great Falls. And it did have a color shift compared to the one that was color managed. But it was still very nice. All it needs then is just, a little bit of tuning. And it should work just right. And the Pro 100 seems to handle that paper just fine on the regular feeder. So amazing. And Dag Leslie Hanson says, I got 16 out of 20 videos nested from you. So he's gonna, yeah. All right. Thank you, Dag. Yeah, keep watching my videos, man. And let those ads run so that we can earn some money. Whew, it's hard. It's hard, let me tell you. They recommend that you do not rest on your laurels just trying to make YouTube your only source. Again, that's why I'm looking at all of these other options. Again, remember, guys, patreon.com, a couple of dollars every month. You won't even feel it. And it just adds up. It adds up, and it's for sure revenue that comes into the channel. They take a very small amount of money to maintain, for their costs, operating costs. But that's a great way. My PayPal button on the channel itself. I'll take you guys there so that you can see what I'm talking about. That helps the channel as well. I hate to be bringing all of this up. I mean, but again, the reality is that you just cannot survive on air. So we need to come up with various ways to support the channel or any other venture that you try to get on YouTube. So here is a please consider donation. You just click on that, and there it is. You just write the amount you want. Here we have Facebook group. Join us. Just join us. Here's another person that wants to join. We'll approve it. Boom. Next. So yeah, we have many options. Here is Patreon. You go to Patreon, become a patron. It is very easy to do. And of course, the Amazon. Oh my, this is my refilling website for the Precision Colors inkset for the Pro 1. This is what I where I set Pro 1 PGI 29 modified cards ready to be refilled. You can buy chips from Precision Colors and their wonderful brand new signature edition inkset for the Pro 1. Works fantastically. I have videos here for you to learn how to do the process. I sell empty T58 cartridges that you can modify and use them for refilling. This is the best way to go. This is better than any refillable card for the 3880 and 3800 you can possibly get. These are my refilling tips that I sell. They already have been machined to the proper tip slot so that they deliver ink correctly. And the last item here, besides the R2000 adjustment program, which I just have here for anyone who needs it, is the one-on-one phone consultations. And you set up a time with me and I will walk you through. Set up a bunch of questions that you need help with. You're going to get the best one-on-one possible help. I will be able to connect with your computer and I will walk you through anything you want to know about your print settings. If you're having problems with a color shift, if you need help installing something to do with printing, set that up for me. This is the cheapest price you will ever find anywhere. So again, these are my ways to diversify my income with YouTube. And so let's see what else we have here. Amazon, yes. The Amazon influencers page, or the, what are they called? Affiliate. I just added a bunch of Moab papers. Again, you can buy anything from here, anything at all, or come into this page and search for anything you want. Okay, that's all you have to do. And I don't know if I showed you guys the last time, got my first check from Amazon. So that is great. That is for like the last 3 months, because you have to reach a $100 threshold. And they either send you a gift card through Amazon or a check. I'd rather have a check. So I waited the extra time to make it past that $100 threshold. And so I got it here. I'll just put that on my checking account. That'll go to the household budget and help out. So that is it. That is the options that we have at this point. I will be adding the channel for ordering the ICC profiles, custom made. And again, always remember to leave some guestbook entries here. You can just click on that and enter and then write something, write me a comment, anything you want to write, and I can get back to you right here in this little box. So that's a good way to also communicate with me. So I'm going to put this link on the Facebook. It's already there. And I'm going to put this link on my description, some videos from now on. So I think that's about it. Let's see what else we got on the chat. Got a $2 super chat from Gary W-N-E-K. Thank you, Gary. And I appreciate that a lot. Andrew Dennis, one thing, it would be great if you could put out several links to a good sampler and related deals as you know about them. Okay. There is another company that a lot of people do not know too much about. Paper company. Let me see if I can find them here. Ink Press. So Ink Press produces some very good papers. Ink Press. And you can get them through Autorama if you want, or Amazon. And I have some of my Amazon affiliate page right now. So here we go. So Ink Press, they have tons of great papers. And so that's another source for sample packs. Moab has a sample pack. Hanamiel has a sample pack, several. Ink Press, Red River, Canson, you name them, Epson. Epson has several as well. Canon has a couple of sample packs as well. So you just gotta, don't rely on me to find those deals for you. You just have to search and you will find those deals. They're out there. And example, on eBay, I found Ink Press. Two types of sample packs. And I think it was like 10 papers each. Two sheets a piece for fine art as well as your regular common photo papers. So that would be like 20 different types of paper times two sheets each. Now, follow me here. $5 each pack. Free shipping from Adorama. This was years ago. I ordered $200 worth. So I guess I got, what, 20 sample packs of each category. And then I removed every pair of paper, compiled it, and put them in my own little envelope. So I ended up with 20 times 2, 40 sheets of each paper. Times 20 types of paper. So that's 40 times 20 plus for $200, which would have been a heck of a lot more had I ordered, you know, the regular boxes. So that was one strategy to use. And I still have those there. And I just need to find the time also to go ahead and start running some prints through those papers, running some images and test them out, create some profiles, you know. And it's just a matter of not enough time in the day to do that, or night to do that. But at least I have them. Those papers are still available for, you know, purchase even today. So that is one more thing I need to do. And so that is on the so-called bucket list. All right, so I think I covered just about everything that I had written down here. Let's continue to look at chat here, and then we'll go ahead and it's been about an hour and a half so far. Oh, guys, let me show you something really crazy before I begin again. I just remember this. I do this quite often. My wife drives me. I drive my wife crazy. So let me show you. I thought I was nuts to have gone almost, I think we did one of the live streams was like 3 hours. And I thought, okay, that is ridiculous. That is way too long. Nick Nimmin is a YouTuber that specializes in YouTube strategy for creators. And he is actually living in Thailand. He just did a live stream. And this is weekly. 4 hours ago, and it was, if you can see right here, 5 hours, 58 minutes, and 21 seconds in length. How does he go to the bathroom? I can't last that long. I really cannot last that long. So that is nuts. Truly, truly nuts. Let me go ahead and just minimize this. We still have 38 people on board. That's wonderful. Let's move over the chat over here so I can expand it and continue on. And then when we're done with all the questions, we'll just go ahead and say goodbye and sign off. And we'll be seeing you then the following week. So Bob Bruce says the watercolor media type also works great with a P400. P400 is pigment printer. It is the analog or the newer version of the R2000. It should work great. Plus, the great thing about it is that it doesn't share the black channel, so there is no PK to MK switch. You have matte black, you have photo black, and when you choose, you know, matte paper, as you would in this case, or watercolor paper, it will switch over and use the proper black for you. The only thing is, it does not have grays. So for monochrome type printing, it doesn't give you as good a linearity across for all of the tonalities from the deepest to the lightest. You may have some slight tonal changes halfway through, but it produces great strong color. It has orange and red ink, which really helps in that region. Also great for portraits because the orange and the red kick in to produce really great looking skin tones. They don't have to be composited by the use of yellow and magenta together. Okay, Gary W-N-E-K, I can't pronounce that. About to switch to precision colors from Canon on the Pro 100. I can mix PC color black and PM in the same tank. And P, what? PC color black and PM. I don't know what you mean. I'll tell you what I think you're asking. Other than yellow, because the original OEM yellow ink has certain characteristics that cause it to react with anything with water. So most third-party dye inks are water-based. And so when you have a yellow card that's low and you try to top it off with PC inks, that's a water-based ink, the ink will migrate through and start mixing with the existing remaining yellow ink, and it will cause a gelling action when the conditions are perfect. In other words, the channels, the planets have to be aligned just right. It happens, but it doesn't happen 100% of the time. But it happened, and it happened to me. I was one of the first ones to get grabbed by that reaction, and it freaked me out at first. But anyway, so the thing is, the practice is to use a replacement yellow cartridge that they will provide you. You take the chip from your original yellow card, you install it on that replacement card. Don't make the mistake of thinking that the chip that's on that card will work. No, that is a CLI-8 card that has been pre-flushed, pre-modified. And now you can load that with Precision Colors yellow ink. You still need the chip from your original card on that replacement card. That's it. I just had a big discussion with someone on the YouTube comment section. Finally, it was like pulling teeth. Finally, I got it that, oh, you're trying to reset your original CLI-8 cartridge and thinking it's going to reset and be able to be used on the Pro 100 as a original yellow card. No, you have to swap the chip. The two types of cards are identically physically. So yes, that's why they can be used. They are physically identical, but you still need the chip. The chip is specific to the Pro 100. So you need to swap the chip. That allows you to then use that cartridge that they provided you. You load it up with yellow PC ink and you have no problem. No more gelling problem because you're not making it contact the other yellow. Now, if you're worried about original OEM yellow still in the printhead, as soon as it does the purge cycle, it's gone. So now you're running on PC yellow ink. From that point on, you will have no problem whatsoever. Mike Burnham, sample packs on is the very first one on the list. Yeah. Oh, okay. Got it. Let me go back and see. Do I have? No, I think I left it. But yeah, go to the Red River site. Sample packs is the first one on the list. That's Michael has said right here. So yeah, get those sample packs. Again, if you're starting to print photos, my recommendation simply is get whatever printer you want to get, set it up with your OEM inks, master that printer. If you're beginning to print, if you're an experienced printer, that you already know what you're doing. But if you're just beginning to get into this, get that printer, Pro 100, Pro 10, Canon, whatever, Epson P600, if you get a PA100, whatever you get, set it up, learn it, master it. The only way you know what the printer can produce or how it can perform is to have the proper baseline, that is, use original inks on that printer. Learn how to use the driver. Don't even start doing any color management type workflow. Print through the driver. Make sure you calibrate your monitor so that the images that you're looking at on your monitor are correctly rendered. That way you can trust your edits, okay? Start your printer with a reference image. That reference image is available where? Now I can show you. Let's go to my Facebook. If you're on a desktop, it will be right here, files. And then you scroll down. I got a ton of files you can download for free. Okay, so you're gonna look for the one that says printer evaluation image, version 002, Profoto, TIFF. Download that bad boy, Printed how? Tell the printer to print it on ProLuster, on semi-gloss, or whatever. Choose photo printing on the driver. That's on a Canon printer. Or the Epson printer, again, just pick Epson standard sRGB as your color mode and pick the paper that you're using. Try to be using a paper from that brand so that, you know, it will kind of match. So if Canon paper, use a Canon printer, use a Canon paper. Epson printer, use an Epson paper. And print that reference image. Look at that reference image as it emerges under some bright light, as close to daylight as possible. It should look correct. You've seen this numerous times in my videos. It should look correct. That is the printer verification, that the printer by itself, without any influence from anything, can take values from a perfect image that was not influenced by you editing and fiddling with it, regardless of what it looks like on your monitor. You print it, you look at it, oh, this looks perfect. When you go back to your monitor and you match it, there's a difference. Your monitor is displaying it different than what you see. That means your monitor is off. The monitor has to be brought back to what? So that it displays what you have in your hands, okay? That is done through calibration, through a hardware type calibrator. Spider is about here, X-Rite is up here, okay? Simply put, no offense intended, but that is the case. So you need to bring that monitor to a condition that matches the output of that perfect image printed by your driver without any control, just the driver itself. Canon ProLuster, you pick Canon ProLuster. Epson Premium Glossy, you pick Epson Premium Glossy as the paper type and print it. And so once you have that, and then once you bring your monitor to the condition that it now matches that output, then everything you added will make sense. Okay, any minute change you make will be reflected on that print. Otherwise, it's just a guessing game. You're printing blindly and you're wondering why your results are not consistent. So that's what you got to do first. And that's once you get past that, then you're good to go. You're on the road to then experimenting with other papers, experimenting with you know, other types of media and so on. You start printing with ICC profiles. You start printing with other inks, you know, and so on. But you have to start with the basics and at least establish a baseline that you know that you are a situation where everything is standardized. And that's it. After I get done with this, I'm going to talk to you about calibration of the Pro 1000, because somebody just today asked that very question. And they really did not know how to answer it. Okay, and I think we'll cut this a little short tonight, unless people have a lot of questions to ask after we get done here. Give my throat a little rest. Okay, so Courtney Jackson, you've been here with us all evening, Courtney. Thank you. Do you really need to calibrate your scanner if you already calibrated your screen to print? Ah, okay. All right, so yes, scanner and your screen are two totally different entities. You scan something, it puts out something that may not have been reproduced correctly. So the i1 studio software and the i1 studio hardware, which is just a Color Monkey photo that has been redressed, okay, different chassis, but it's the same hardware. Or this one here, the i1 Pro 2, you can calibrate your scanner. Here's my scanner right here. I have a standard that I will scan, okay? It will produce the scan, and then it knows how far each color, the way it was reproduced by that and read by that, is off. So it will take, I didn't explain that correctly. It knows the original values of the color patches. it will scan them. The scanner will then produce a result, which will either be perfect or deviate this way or that way. And then it will then produce a profile to take care of those mistakes in reproduction. I think that's correct, okay? So that's why it has nothing to do with the way that the monitor will display what this scans. It has everything to do with the way the scanner, as the scanner passes through the it's like a test chart that it has. It will reproduce those colors either correctly or not. And then it will then create a curve or a profile. They call it a lookup table that will then dictate for each one of those colors. If they were reproduced wrongly, it will then insert or, you know, it will write in, I'm having a hard time here. It will write in a correction value to compensate for that error. I think that's it. So again, I am not a color engineer, so my language and my way to express myself when it comes to this types of technology is totally off. So anyway, that is it. And then you'll end up with a profile that you will then apply every time you scan something. So if you're scanning photographs for retouching and for restoration type work, which I do as well, and we'll do some videos on that soon. I'll show you some of my results. Then you want a scanner that is so accurate that, you know, it will actually reproduce exactly what the original looks like on image. Then if your monitor is correctly calibrated, then the two are sort of married together and you will be able to get a very accurate rendition of what the original looked like. And then you can apply whatever color correction you want to it. So yeah, it is actually different, separate, and very much required if you're doing a lot of work with scanners. That's why they included it in this software. Okay, so Courtney again asked, do you really need to calibrate your... Okay, you asked that twice. Sorry. Adam McKenzie, so are you saying, Jose, that as it relates to the Canon Pro 100, that I should set my media to matte or fine art? Okay. See, as far as the Pro 100 goes, because it's not a pigment printer, it does not have matte black, picking fine art and matte will have no effect. Okay, because it's using only photo black, the black that it comes with. That's it. So with a pigment printer, a Canon one, when you choose fine arts, it'll kick in or trigger the use of PK. I mean, of matte K. So when you use the common matte choice, it will use photo black, which is totally makes no sense. Because for matte paper, you need matte black, not photo black. But for whatever the reason, the engineers have done it this way. Pro 10 Pro 1 will use photo black when you choose the regular matte paper choice. When you choose fine art matte paper choice, it will trigger PK. I mean, Jesus, matte K. Pro 100 doesn't have matte ink, so it doesn't really matter. Fine art choice will actually take into account thickness and will force you to use the manual feeder in the rear of the printer. I have printed on the Canson water aquarella paper on the Pro 100, just on the top tray, okay? And just use the regular matte setting. Now, you may end up having to do a manual adjustment on color. Or if you have capabilities to create profiles, you can create a profile using the matte paper choice. That way you can print borderless if you want to. Or at least with any kind of border instead of the one that they impose every time you use the fine art paper choice. You will have a 30 to 35 millimeter leading and trailing edge border imposed. There's a good reason for that. Has to do with head strikes. Okay. And Adam also says, you are so true about ink press. I bought a couple, including their canvas. Yeah, they're good papers. I tell you, I got to go back and I have probably over 50 different paper types that I have to go back and test. And again, it's just overwhelming amount of work. And so I think about it often, but it's just taking that first step to start doing it, doing the work. But, you know, I have other things in the way to before I can have the luxury to start messing around with those other types of papers and provide you guys with results that you all, I know, want to see, you know, but it's just so much time involved that I just have not gotten to it. But yeah, they make great papers. They're wonderful. I have a ton of them. And again, it's going to be fun once I find the time to do that. It is one of the things I really want to accomplish this year. So Adam wants to know, Spike597 says that the audio is fine. Nico Hanila, I would like to watch whole live sessions, but it is already 2:07 a.m. in Finland. So yeah, don't worry about it. You can catch it tomorrow at your leisure. It'll be on as a regular video. You can just click on it and view it. You can just skip the section you already saw and get to the rest of it. We will not be on too much longer, I promise you. And somebody says the audio is fine here. Great. Adam McKenzie, not sure if you had addressed my question. Can I use the Moab Desert Varnish on the absolutely on the Aquarella Canson paper? Yes, absolutely. Yeah, it works quite well. The reason to use that is because this is uncoated paper and the inks will actually sink more into the paper fibers. They tend to spread a little bit more. The paper has some sort of sizing on the surface, but it's really intended for paint, okay, for watercolor painting. So applying a protective coating from any of the major manufacturers will impart a little bit more contrast to the results. They will not look as dull as they normally do on an uncoated paper. It'll actually look a little bit better, a little deeper, a little stronger color. And of course, it also protects the image, so the print. And Courtney wants to know, so ink press sells all types of paper? Yes, they do. Yes, they do. And you can get them through Adorama, by the way, and also on Amazon. Check out my Amazon button and try to order anything from them, and you will be fine. You will be quite impressed. Get the sample packs first and play with those. But before you do that, make sure you download that standard image from my Facebook page. If you haven't joined yet, join. We have over 600 dedicated printing nuts as members. And so if anyone can answer any question you have, it'll be there. Not just me, it'll be all of the other members. Some of them are quite expert. So yeah, and then that way, if you get those sample packs, you should be able to start, you know, exploring different looks, different types of renditions. Spike597 says, is there anything from Canon about increasing the paper length of the Pro 1000? No, not at all. 25.6, I think it is. That's it. So there's nothing that you can do now. The only thing that Pro 1000 can do is it can allow you to cancel that limitation for that border. Okay. So when you're printing with fine art, you can just tell it to forget it. Don't impart that border. That 35 millimeter border. And that's wonderful. That's one of the good things that you can do with it. But as far as the length, no, they want you to buy the Pro one, the Pro 2000. Just think, if they allowed you to print panoramas with the Pro 1000, nobody would buy the Pro 2000. So, and that's it's a marketing ploy. And Ed Trinidad says, checking in from Snowy, Vermont. You just joined us, man? Boy, you missed a lot, but catch us on the replay and you should be able to enjoy what we were discussing. Spike597, I am also wondering if there is anything I should know about purchasing 24-inch wide photo paper, trimming it into 17-inch lengths and running it through the Pro 1000. The problem with that is that because of the curl that a roll normally has, I do that too, don't get me wrong. you're going to have the curl in the wrong direction. It's going to be like this. So we think about it, 24 inches wide and by 17. So then you're going to print that in this way. You're going to have curling in this direction, and that can cause problems. I don't think that vacuum assisted advance is strong enough to flatten papers properly that are already very curly. You might need like a piece of a core tube and kind of counter curl that curl out of it, and that should work. I mean, I have a couple of rolls of 24 inch wide paper from Red River that I was just planning exactly that. Okay, exactly that. And the problem is you will have to counter curl that built-in, you know, curl of the paper so that it is rather flat when it enters, and then the vacuum advance can take care of any slight curliness that might exist. And Adam McKenzie says, you never answered my second part of the question, which was, should I leave the ICC profile on auto? You got to remind me, were we on the Pro 100? So yes, let the driver handle it. Again, let me tell you what I'm, show you what I'm talking about. If that is what you are asking about, then yes. Okay. So say I'm going to print on aquarella paper. I'm going to choose photo printing. No borderless, because remember, those papers are odd sizes. So they would have to actually, you would have to actually create a custom paper size. And if you don't know how to do that, I will take you through a quick little tutorial on that as well. So you would not set it on none. Just leave it alone. Leave everything alone. Undo that box. Photo papers, matte photo paper. And then on the size, you go to custom. And then here, enter your paper size. Okay, the custom paper size, and click OK. And then it'll set that paper size just one time. You'll have to redo that again. There, as far as I know, there's no way to save custom paper sizes like you can on an Epson printer. And you can then choose high or standard. I use standard simply because there's more dot gain. In other words, a droplet of ink will spread. And so the lower resolution printing is fine. It's just perfect for that. High resolution printing, in other words, higher, more dots packed in one square inch, tend to sort of blend together, and it kind of looks a little bit muddier than it looks on the regular standard resolution. That's just one tip for uncoated papers, for printing on uncoated papers. So that is it. I hope that was the question you were asking about. And so there you go. Okay, now what was I going to bring up? Totally forgot. Yep, I sure did. Anyway, okay, so we are closing on the 2-hour mark. I'll wait another couple of minutes. Let me see if I can remember what the heck it was that I was going to ask or tell you guys about. It'll come to me tonight, and then I'll kick myself. It was something that a commenter had made a comment about. I mentioned that earlier. If anybody can remember with better brain memory retention than mine, maybe they can provide me with what it was that I was going to talk about. But, oh yeah. Let me think. It was about the Pro 1000. Hector A. Rodriguez is here. Hello, you just got here, buddy? Or you just got chiming in now, but you've been on board, I hope. Welcome. Let's see who we have here. 34 people still on board. Wow. Okay. Let's see if there's anything. There's a couple of you Pro 1000 owners here that I wanted to ask you this. Let me go ahead and ask. I just installed new operating system on my computer just recently. I started getting some really odd read-write problems with my hard drive. So I couldn't solve it, so I just refreshed the system completely and reinstalled only the basic software that I use. So I reinstalled the Pro 1000 via USB, and then I installed the accounting manager, and I cannot get it to recognize the printer, even though it is installed. So here's my accounting manager. Normally what you do is you click here and add a printer, and it should then find the printer. After you search, it should find the Pro 1000, and yet it doesn't see it. But of course, Pro 1000 is right here. There it is. And if you were wondering whether it actually is there or not, there are my ink levels. So yeah, I don't understand what's going on. I would like to get my accounting manager working again so I can do some cost type calculations, because people are really getting worried about the level of maintenances that the Pro 1000 kind of does behind your back. And you can literally use half of your ink in just maintenance. And so that is something that I wanted to look into a little closer. I did have some figures prior to this mishap with the hard drive. And now, of course, I lost that information, because once you wipe your hard drive clean and start all over again, it's all gone. So, but for some reason, I just cannot get the accounting manager to work. Paper configuration finds it, or media configuration tool finds it. Here's the media configuration. This is what you use to configure other than OEM Canon media to the printer. You can save that as paper types. And of course, there it is, Pro 1000, see? So I don't know what's going on. I would like to solve that, but again, I really hate calling Canon about this, because it's just too much of a hassle. And often the person you're talking with really doesn't know that much. So anyway, so Hector says that it's snowing in Chicago. Well, I'm glad it's in Chicago and not here. That's all I got to say. I am not a fan of snow. And Adam McKenzie says, no, Jose, what the ICC profile should be, I'm using the plugin on Canon. Okay. Okay, Print Studio Pro is what you're asking about. Yeah, just leave it on auto. It takes over, literally, really, it does. Just leave it on auto. Or if you choose Pro, that will also work, either one. PSP will kind of take over for you. It's really wonderful. And it's meant for someone who doesn't want to deal with color management and all the aspects of it. So that should work for you. Mike Vernon says, do you know where I can buy some empty Pro 1000 carts? Nowhere I've looked. Okay, I was fortunate enough to have a person from Australia literally send me her empties. And so that was wonderful. And I know that it wasn't cheap for her to ship them from there. But I got my set that I have in the machine now. And then I have another set that I pre-filled already. So I want to have two sets on hand. And then that's going to be it. That is all I'm going to have. I'll have to get some chips from Precision Colors to install on the carts that are currently on the printer. You saw earlier that I have about that much ink on each cart. And I'll be replacing my maintenance cart as well very soon on that bad boy. But yeah, they're very rare. Again, you just got to contact on the Facebook group. I don't know if you're a member I think you are. Just put out the notice, see if anyone's willing to sell them to you. Yes, I did uninstall and reinstall the account manager. Yep. Did not do a thing. And again, the previous time it worked flawlessly. So, and it really doesn't matter whether you install the Pro 1000 as a USB directly or USB and then using Wi-Fi or even network. It will scan for any kind of connection to that printer. What you saw me do included both USB direct connection or Wi-Fi or network. So I don't know why it's not communicating with it or finding it. Ed Spence says, I always leave my Pro 10 on to avoid cleaning, but I've noticed it making sounds that might be a clean cycle. I understand that there is ink agitation cycle and also goes through. Is that what I hear? Very likely. Yeah. The Pro 10 cartridges have paddles inside the bag. And the printer calls it, the driver calls it something to do with ink quality or something like that. Let me see. You can actually run that yourself manually. So you go to the maintenance tab and let's see if we can find it here. Ink quality maintenance, okay? Equalizes the density of ink to maintain ink quality. All that is that it's just agitating the ink, okay, inside the cartridge. So the little paddles are kind of floating inside like little rowboat oars. So it'll take the head and start going like that, back and forth. Pro 2000 does that as well. The original OEM carts have BBs inside that move around when you're printing. And if you're having printed for a while, before it'll print, it'll do an agitation cycle. So that is exactly what is happening now. You'll be able to recognize, if you want to actually visualize on a Canon printer, whether it's a cleaning cycle or not. If you lift the lid, all printing stops. There's a sensor, a little rectangular hole. Just roll up some paper and shove it in there. And that will tell the sensor that the lid is closed when in reality it's open. So lift the lid up, stick a little sensor in there, and then start a print job. And if a cleaning cycle is generated, what will happen is their head that is normally parked, a little bit of ink will be sucked out, it'll lift up, it'll move over, and then you'll hear that whirling action of the pump as it sucks the aspirator ink out of the perch pad into the waste ink pads. And again, the head will move over, park itself, it'll suck a little bit more ink. The sucking is silent almost. It'll suck a little bit more ink, lift up, move, whirl, 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 and that will be drained. Now, after each print that you make, about 30 seconds after you finish a print, the printhead will lift itself up, move over, and the perch pad will be emptied. And it will come over and sit. Nothing else happens. It's just the emptying of the perch pad. Okay, if there's any ink there collected, it's being drawn out. It's not performing a cleaning cycle. So people think that after each print is running a cleaning cycle. That's not the case. It's just simply emptying or purging the ink or the purge pad, that's what it's called, out of any collected ink that may be there. So that is something that people need to realize, and they are not really losing ink at that point. But if you wait a number of hours, again, remember, some people are in total denial. Before you print, it'll do that cleaning cycle. And the 9500 from Canon, there was a leaked document that was leaked several years ago indicating just that. And it told you exactly how much ink was being wasted for each period of non-use, 60 hours, 120, 240, and 480, progressively more and more ink. And if you unplug it off the wall, then it assumes that you had it for 480 hours of non-use. And it's quite an extensive cleaning that it does. And realize that there's only about 15 ml of ink in each of the cartridges. You have 10 cartridges. That's a lot of ink you're gonna throw out, you know. So it's about maybe 6 mL total across the board, and yeah, that's a lot of ink. You better put that ink on paper instead of, you know, wasting it just because you were saving money by not printing. It makes no sense. All right. Okay, so Hector says that he was out shoveling snow in Chicago. Oh boy, better you than me. I don't even have a snow shovel. I broke it last year, and I have yet. I thought that if I don't buy one, then it won't snow. If I buy one, then you will get a blizzard, you know, so. Okay, so. Okay. Explain Pro in Canon Prince Pro Studio. It's actually Prince Studio Pro, but we'll open up Photoshop and I'll load up an image, and we'll open up the plugin. So I did a restoration of a image for someone, and we'll go ahead and open Print Studio Pro. So, File, Automate, Canon, Print Studio Pro. Takes a while for it to be transferred over to Print Studio Pro. And let's see if I can maximize this. So here is the choice that you have. You have, let's just say we're going to print this on the Canon Pro 1000 or any kind of printer, say the Pro 10. And we'll choose the paper, Pro Luster. And letter size, we're going to leave all the layout by itself. See how it says right here, use ICC profile. Color management, click on that, use ICC profile. On the printer profile, you have auto, or you can just find it yourself, and then perceptual. It seems that they took out pro, maybe it's here in the color handling. Nope. Used to exist before, okay, and now it's even simpler to use. This will automatically turn off color matching in the driver and automatically print to the correct ICC profile. It's a no-brainer, okay, a no-brainer. You can choose, all you got to do is choose your rendering intent. For anything with skin tones, I recommend relative colorimetric. For landscapes or anything else where color shifting doesn't really matter, for if you have outer gamma colors that are pushed in, internal colors that are already in gamma will be shifted. So for a landscape, that's really not that big a deal. But for portraiture, you don't want skin tones to be shifted. So I recommend perceptual for non-people pictures and relative colorimetric for a little bit more accurate colors that are already in gamma reproduction. They will not be shifted. So you have auto, again, simple. You're just gonna pick your profile by yourself, or let the auto system pick it up for you automatically. And that is about it. I don't even see the, oh, here we go, Pro Mode. So Pro Mode, again, is, let's see, what is the deal here? Pro Mode, I think, just automatically does that as well. I'm not entirely sure. I never use it. I just use ICC profile and boom, it does it automatically for me. So this is not something that I use a lot, this plugin, because again, it's really intended to be more of an automatic type color management process. So you don't have to worry about it. But I normally just print through the application itself and not a plugin. and I assign my own profile. I know which one's the correct one, and so I don't deal with this. But again, the simplest way for you to do this is to simply use your ICC profile choice right there in auto, and it will then pick the correct profile for this particular paper or this particular paper or whatever paper you choose. As long as it's Canon, that's what it'll use. Now, when you're using, I think it's when you're using color management and you created a profile or you bought a paper from a third party manufacturer that uses, tells you to use a specific paper type, then you have to assign the profile yourself. And maybe that's why they have Pro Mode. I am not sure. At this point, I'm sorry, I cannot answer that question, because I don't see a way for me under Pro Mode to be able to access a third-party ICC profile, for instance. Weird. Okay. I apologize. I wasn't able to give you the answer you were probably looking for, but again, it's just something that I have not played around too much with, and probably if you do a YouTube search, you might be able to find some explanation how that actually works. What is the difference between the two modes? Whether they are identical in output? I did one video a long time ago where I did manual, pro, I did auto, and all of the results were identical. So, which was very surprising to me. I thought I was going to get different in rendition, but all of the results turned out to be totally identical. So, Robert Paul Knight. Hi, Jose. I have just bought an Epson Stylus Photo 1400. Can I use non-OEM inks on it? Sure you can. Will they reproduce color correctly? Of course not. They won't. So, you have to rely on ICC profiles, or you have to rely on companies that sell so-called OEM matched third-party inks, and then get a good set of refillable cartridges. If you buy the compatible cartridges, the color is totally off. So you have to end up profiling those. It really is just not worth it. So if you want to go ahead and use non-OEM on the 1400, I have a 1400 myself, and all you have to do is get a set of refillable carts. Fill it up with Precision Colors, with Ink Republic, a couple of Inkjet Carts US, many companies that sell really good third-party dye ink sets for the Pro 100. And you'll get a very good match. You'll be able to use the original OEM profiles for either Epson papers or third-party papers, using their profiles. Remember, profiles by these companies are always produced for OEM ink and not third-party inks. But if the third-party ink is well matched, you should be able to use those profiles with good results. John Hewton says it's 105 in the UK, so yeah, go to bed, my friend, and enjoy the rest of the weekend, and hope to see you soon again. Adam McKenzie, it was a Pro on the Pro 100 printer, yeah. So again, the same, I think you were referring to PSP again. Pro 100, again, the same thing. Pro 100 automatically will pick the correct profile as long as it's a Canon profile and a Canon paper. It's pretty much, I want to say idiot-proof. It's not, but if this idiot can do it, then most people can, because I'm not the smartest guy in the world. Yeah, on the Pro 100, actually, there's a little trick that you can do that's quite interesting. I'll leave you guys with that little nugget. If you go to the preferences and you choose the color manage intensity adjustment here, color matching. Now watch what happens. When you pick ICM, you get this. You can leave it on auto. See that? Auto will pick the correct profile depending on the paper that you choose. So printing through the driver on the Canon printer is pretty much either way will work, okay? Other makes, not so much, but it will work. So once you are in ICM, you can manually pick your profile. You see that? Just like we did on the PSP. So if you are going to print on a given paper, for instance, let's see, the Pro 100 with, semi-gloss, boom, you pick that profile. You're actually printing through a profile while telling Photoshop not to control color, or telling Lightroom not to control color. Whether you do it through the driver or whether you do it through the application and tell the driver not to control color, your results will be identical. And that is what PSP is doing for you. It is automatically just for color management in automatic mode. You just cannot beat that. So don't fret too much about that. Just leave it on auto and the results will be good, as long as you're using Canon papers and OEM ink, of course, or well-matched third-party ink. Ed Trinidad says, I set up the task lamp. Oh, okay. I set up a task lamp with a 5500K blah, blah, blah bulb and a flashlight diffuser. Killed a hotspot reflection to inspect my prints. Big difference in color matching my monitor correctly. Great. Yeah, you're doing it the right way. I need to do that as well. I don't really have a so-called perfect way to look at my prints. I use my umbrella because the lights that I have behind the umbrella are 5500K. And the umbrella by itself produces a very even lighting with no hotspots. So anytime I want to look at a print, I just turn on my umbrella and my studio light, in other words, and directly read it. So ICM relates to just Canon papers? Yes, that's it. That is it. If you're going to use third-party papers, third-party profiles, and OEM inks, then you have to set it to none and then tell Photoshop or Lightroom to, you know, print through the correct profile. That's it. That's the only way. So, all right, I think we might be done for the evening. So again, we've just gone over 2 hours and 17 minutes. That's wonderful. And I think I discussed everything that I wanted to discuss. Watch me remember what I wanted to talk to you guys about the minute that I sign off. I know that'll happen. If I could only remember. Okay, that is it for now. Again, Monday, remember, I'll have the video on the results of the PCK3 HD inks on that super, super glossy paper from Staples. We'll discuss color rendition, linearity, and gloss differential, if any. And then I will do a little show and tell of some 13 by 19s of some images. Some of them are very subtle. Some of them are a little bit demanding as far as color. And we'll see how the inks perform. So that should be fun. And then we'll go ahead and start tackling that sublimation system and other things, other papers and such. So I'll say good night for now. Thank you so much for being here tonight with me. Mike Vernon says, I skidded what I said. What would you, please repeat again. I don't want to leave without, if I skip something that you wanted me to talk about, go ahead and post it right now and I will take care of it. He says that I skidded what you said. In other words, I skidded your question. So please refresh my mind what it was, and then I'll try to answer it before I say goodbye. I'll wait a few more minutes. Let me see if I can find Mike a little earlier here. This happens when you are live, folks. This is the real deal, unedited. Oh, well, I cannot find it. So, again, I want to thank all the super chatters that provided some income tonight for the channel. This is great. Tomorrow I'll know what we actually earned, and I'll tell you guys on video, edited, nice edited video later on. And so, again, thank you guys for that, always supporting us here. All right, he's not answering, so I think that is it for tonight. Thank you so much. Don't forget to keep subscribing, sharing, and liking. Join that Facebook group. We are a great bunch of people. Again, we have a ton of people. Ah, here we go. Mike Vernon, I had a similar problem today with the all-in-one printer, and Windows had some kind of update, and I run it and solve the printer problem. What are you referring to, Mike? My problem with the accounting software? I've tried uninstalling it. If that's what you're talking about, I've tried uninstalling it and reinstalling it, and it just does not see my printer at all. So, Spike597 says, Mike Vernon had a similar problem today with an all-in-one printer, and Windows had some sort of update, and I run it and solve the printer problem. Yeah, that's what he is saying. But I don't know what reference we're creating here, whether you mean, again, the only problem I've had since I reinstalled Windows 10. When you do Windows 10 now, you're able to refresh, and what it does is that it knows that you have a genuine copy of Windows 10. It goes to the server and downloads the very latest version of Windows 10. And that's what it installs. So it includes all of the up-to-date updates. So it's not like you're going back to the disk and then you have to update, you know, to the present day. Windows 10 is going to be more like the Mac OS now. It's going to be constantly updated. So, okay, Mike Vernon says yes. So I have the very latest up-to-date version of Windows 10. I also had the same version, but maybe not so up to date when it was working. So all I can say is that I tried installing it twice, in fact yesterday, and it still did not see the Pro 1000. Other Canon softwares that deal with the printers, like the media configuration tool, do see it. So I don't know, can't figure it out. So anyway, that is it. Thank you so much again. Like I said, don't forget to subscribe, share, and like. Until the next time, happy printing, everybody. And those mugs, those t-shirts, are going to be ready in about a week. So thanks so much again. Bye-bye. Oh, boy. Ed Trinidad, before I go, oh, thank you. Wait a minute. Not going yet. Don Ku. You know what that is. Don Ku is Puerto Rican rum with honey and a twist of lime for your throat. Buenas noches. Time to shovel the deck. Oh, God. Don't even say that. That's gonna cause us to have some snow. That snow from you is heading this way. I just know it. But thank you, Ed. All right, so Adam McKenzie says, can you send a link to the Canson ICC profile? No, there's no Canson ICC profile. Are we talking about the Aquarella paper? I'm using the Epson ICC profile. That's what I use to print on that. And for the Pro 1000, I'm using just a matte paper profile. For the Pro 100, I use just the matte paper setting. I'm letting the driver handle everything. I think that's what you're asking. So I did not make a Canson ICC profile for that particular paper. Mike Vernon says Windows update. And Mike Vernon says today's update. So I'll check again. I'll run a Windows update to see if there's anything available. I have it on automatic, so it's doing it like behind my back. So we'll see. All right, that will be it for now. Thank you so much. Let me go ahead and log off here. Bye-bye, everybody.